Thank you all for coming here today. Thank you to Father Allen and Dr. Barbara Wall. Thank you. I'm very grateful to be here as the Thomas Martin Fellow. I knew Tom Martin. I would see him at conferences. Tom was delightful, and he was vivace. I mean, you always knew he was there in the room. I'm glad to carry on his legacy for this semester. Okay, the title of my talk is, I didn't write it down, so I have to remember my title. Best Friends You've Never Heard Of, Eavesdropping on Augustine and His Closest Companions. So, actually, I do a lot of work on councils that Augustine orchestrated with other leaders of the church in North Africa, and I do a lot of nitty-gritty stuff with canons from those councils, but I'm not going to do that today with you all. Today, we're just going to have fun with Augustine, and we're going to be on the road with Augustine, traveling here and there. So, today, I will illuminate an aspect of Augustine that scholars seldom explore. I will treat quiet moments in Augustine's life when close friends visited him at home at his monastery in Hippo, and also when he traveled on ecclesiastical business. And again, he was accompanied by close friends always, even when he's traveling. Augustine was blessed with an extensive network of friends whom he often consulted on vexing theological and disciplinary issues. So, when time permitted, these friends sat at table together, either at Hippo or at their own bishopric where they were, sharing fellowship and conversation. Often they rode together to a council within their own province of Numidia. I'll be talking a lot today. I don't think I wrote the word down, but Numidia is a vast province that Augustine is in. Or they'd also be traveling very often to a general council over in Carthage. Carthage is about 200 miles away from Hippo. On horseback or on mules or in horse-drawn carriages, they conversed for hours, trotting past bristling wheat fields and shimmering olive groves. From clues in sermons and from letters and from canons, I will demonstrate today ways in which Augustine's comrades contributed to his vision for a rejuvenated African church. Scripture and lessons learned from his struggles prior to conversion informed Augustine's key decisions, but clearly he also relied on close comrades for inspiration and advice. I will also make a few general observations about hospitality that Augustine extended to Christians who were passing through Hippo. We'll see that in all of these cases, he's working tirelessly to upbuild the church. But like all of us, he needs time for refreshment and relaxation, and he'll get that with his closest friends. As Peter Brown says in his wonderful book, Augustine was never alone. He always has friends, companions with him. So before we saddle up with Augustine, let's briefly survey the historical landscape. What was happening in North Africa during Augustine's era? Why was it incumbent upon him to travel so much? When Augustine became a priest around 391 in Hippo, the Catholic Church in North Africa was in disarray, and it was distinctly in the minority. The dominant religious group there was the Donatists. Now, forgive me, if you've already learned this, just bear with me for a minute or two. The Donatists had broken away from the Catholic Church almost a century earlier in the wake of persecution. From 303 to 305 AD, the Emperor Diocletian commanded Christian clergy to hand over Holy Scripture to be burnt. Troops confiscated and destroyed churches. Many Christians suffered imprisonment, torture, or death. So this is during Diocletian's persecution. It's 303 to 305 in the west. In the eastern part of the empire, it perdures until 311. Especially in North Africa, some Christians regarded the handing over of Scripture as the most heinous of sins. These resolute Christians refused to have any contact with traditores, with people who literally handed over the scriptures to be burned. And you can hear our English word traitor coming out of that word traditor. It comes from the Latin trado tradere, to hand over, but also to hand down. So we get tradition from that verb as well. A formidable priest named Donatus soon became the leader of the resolute group. His name is Donatus, hence the name for his church, the Donatist Church. Harking back to Christianity's early roots, Donatus claimed that they were the Church of the Martyrs. They were the pure church that had never collaborated with the Roman authorities. However, both Catholics and Donatists harbored traditores in their midst. The Donatists were simply reluctant to admit it. Over the years, Donatist clergy developed a reputation for holiness, a reputation not shared by many of their Catholic counterparts. We'll get to that. And I might add, if you converted to Donatism from Catholicism, you had to undergo rebaptism. The Donatists had to rebaptize you. Donatists considered Catholics to be apostates because, you know, we have handed over the scriptures, worse than pagans. So to be an apostate is worse than a pagan, according to the Donatists. So Donatists deemed Catholic baptism to be null and void. Catholics were scandalized at this. Catholics were scandalized that Donatists would repeat the sacrament of baptism, a sacrament that is not to be repeated. Over the years, Augustine developed his theology of baptism against the backdrop of the Donatists' defective sacramental theology. But that's another whole paper in itself. So, violence would flare up sporadically between the Catholics and the Donatists. They were locked in a vicious war of attrition. Keenly aware that the Catholic side was faltering against the Donatist majority, Augustine and Aurelius of Carthage, he was Bishop of Carthage, that's the premier see in this whole region. So Augustine and Aurelius of Carthage inaugurated a series of annual councils to revitalize the Catholic Church in Africa. This was in 393. They'll hold their first council at Hippo. Facing a poorly trained and demoralized episcopate, the two reformers decided that theological instruction should be a component of every council. To combat the Donatists' exclusive claims to purity, Augustine and Aurelius also insisted that the moral conduct of clergy needed to be improved, and clerical holiness must be emphasized. So, over the next three decades, those two men worked tirelessly to foster canonical legislation addressing the myriad ills besetting the Catholic Church. And mind you, this is an era long before we have seminaries. So it was really true, especially of the Catholic clergy, maybe a bit of the Donatist clergy, that a lot of the Catholic clergy were poorly trained. Some of them would even read not from the Bible, but from heretical books during the Mass. I mean, that's how bad it got at times. So first, I'm going to make some general remarks about hospitality extended by Augustine. As bishop, Augustine knew that it was incumbent upon him to provide hospitality to Christian sojourners from far away, especially clergy. Inns and taverns boasted a dubious reputation in the ancient world, so best to be avoided by bishops and priests, if at all possible. And as one of the busiest port cities in North Africa, Hippo itself featured numerous pubs, and they'd be bursting at the seams with patrons by day's end. Apparently, that problem of clergy frequenting the taverns in Hippo and elsewhere in North Africa was so bad that at the very first council that Augustine and Aurelius had in Hippo, that council addressed the issue. Canon 26 from the Council of Hippo in 393 prohibits clergy from frequenting taverns except while on a trip. got the Latin here. You can consult me later if you want it. The Council Fathers recognize that people do need to refresh themselves while on a trip. But the Council Fathers wanted to forfend against not so good behavior locally as best they could. Just on a side note, over 800 years later, when you look at the canons from the Fourth Lateran Council in Rome, so this is 1215 AD, Fourth Lateran, virtually the same canon appears at the Fourth Lateran Council about you must not frequent inns and pubs except if you're on a trip. So this is human behavior which doesn't change, and the fathers were always addressing this. So that's locally in Hippo with the pubs. Out on the Roman roads, which linked the major cities of the empire, you would get an inn about every 25 to 35 miles. These inns were called mansiones, from the Latin word to stay, to remain. So you could spend the night or several night, you could recuperate from the travails of the road in a mansio. But let me just tell you, there were unforeseen hazards abounding in some of these roadside inns. In a famous vignette from one of his satires, the Roman poet Horace paints a charmingly chaotic scene as he stops at a rustic inn in southern Italy with his companions, and they are Maecenas and Virgil. Yes, that Virgil. So already Horace and Virgil were famous. At Beneventum in southern Italy, an attentive host almost burns down his inn while roasting some meat delicacies for his illustrious guests. Sparks fly and set the ceiling alight as the hungry visitors and nervous slaves rush to save the charred meat and the smoking roof. Okay, so now we know of the hazards that go on in the inns. But we have to take leave of our distinguished guests. We've got to return to Hippo now. So back in North Africa, it's best to secure a letter of introduction and dine at the more sober quarters of Bishop Augustine of Hippo. The meal will be modest, but the company will be excellent. In a sermon that Augustine preached late in life, he acknowledges that hospitality has been a concern of his since his earliest days as a bishop. And I'm quoting Augustine here. "I saw that the bishop is under the necessity of showing hospitable kindness to all visitors and travelers. Indeed, if a bishop did not do that, he would be said to be lacking in humanity." But this hospitality could be a bit disruptive in the bishop's quarters, in a monastery. So Augustine decides early on in his episcopate to move into the bishop's house with his clergy, and then his monks will remain in the monastery next door, where they will be not as disturbed by the guests who are always flooding through Hippo, and Augustine is extending hospitality to them. In other sermons, I'll just cite a very few, Augustine cites biblical passages that emphasize hospitality. Martha and Mary welcome Jesus into their home. That's in Sermon 179. The two disciples on the road to Emmaus ask Jesus to dine with them, though they don't recognize him yet. That's in Sermon 235. For Augustine, very simply put, all Christians partake in the body of Christ. Christ is the head. All believers are members of his body. To receive a fellow Christian is to receive Christ. Now, we're finished with general hospitality. I'm going to introduce you very briefly to some of Augustine's closest friends. And I'm sure you've heard of these folks. The first of our dramatis personae is Alypius, got his name on the board here. He's Augustine's dearest friend. Alypius is the most familiar friend to us, appearing as he does in Augustine's Cassiciacum dialogues, in the Confessions, in several of Augustine's letters. Alypius was a few years younger than his famous friend. Both claimed Tagaste as their hometown. I was fortunate enough to get to North Africa. I studied with W.H.C. Friend. He did a lot on North Africa and Donatism. I studied with him at the University of Glasgow Yale let me be over at Glasgow for a bit. Professor Friend encouraged me to get down to North Africa. So I've been there. I'm sure it's much changed since my student days, but in my day, you could take a train from Carthage, which is modern-day Tunis, and the train chugs along. This is the Magerda River Valley, and you're gradually ascending. And so Tagaste, Augustine's boyhood home, and also Olypius's home, Tagaste is up. It's hilly. It's very hilly. There are pine trees. It's a beautiful part. And Tagaste nowadays is just into Algeria. You're crossing from Tunisia, and you're just coming into Algeria to reach Tagaste. So let's see. Augustine was one of Olypius's college teachers when Olypius went down to Carthage for college. Olypius really was Augustine's alter ego. Trained as a lawyer, Olypius worked for the imperial financial administration in Rome and in Milan. He accompanied Augustine as Augustine was over there in Rome and then in Milan. Back in North Africa, Olypius resided at the monastery that Augustine founded in Hippo. Augustine founds the monastery even when he's a priest. He doesn't even wait to be a bishop. And then around 394, the Bishop of Tagaste dies. Olypius becomes bishop there. Olypius was a consummate administrator, and he's always a sounding board for Augustine. Tagaste lies, it's about 60 miles up from Hippo. I'm going into all this geography just to give you a real sense, because even though the Roman roads were good, it's arduous to travel. And actually, when you go over and visit Tunisia and Algeria, you see the Roman roads. Very impressive accomplishment. But nonetheless, it's arduous to travel. So Tagaste is about 60 miles, as I said, it's up in the hill country from Hippo. Fortunately for Augustine, there's a major road, Hippo up to Tagaste, and a major road down to Carthage. Augustine often is preaching over in Carthage. That means he often gets to visit his friend before going over. Another friend, another dear friend of Augustine, was Severus. Severus also hailed from Tagaste, and he knew Augustine from boyhood. We have much less information about Severus, but we do know that he too was a monk at the monastery for several years in Hippo. And then Severus becomes Bishop of Milevis. And that 395-397. Augustine becomes bishop around 395. So Severus is there in the monastery a little bit longer before taking up his post. That's an arduous trip. You've got to come up to near Kalama, and then you get up to Kirta, which changed its name to Constantine. Let me just describe the geography there very briefly. Milevis is 110 miles from Hippo, so it's going to be much harder for Augustine to make that journey. It's 110 miles. The route ascends from Hippo, as you can see, through Kirta Constantine. Kirta is about 1,800 feet up in elevation. It's perched on a high bluff with a steep view down to the river. Kirta was the capital of Numidia, so it's a bustling city. And you also get a road that goes down to the Sahara. Yes, that Sahara. And so you have caravans, even back at this date, bringing up dates and so forth from the Sahara region. And then it's about a day-long trip on foot out to Milevis. I actually live in the mountains. I live at Lake Tahoe in Nevada. The lake is at 6,200 feet elevation. So when you live, so it's kind of isolated, actually. Our nearest city is Reno, but getting down to Reno, Nevada, you're going on a zigzaggy mountain road. So I'm very aware of geography where I live. And you can really be cut off. In the middle of winter, if we get a bad storm, you go nowhere at that elevation. So I'm always very interested in geography. So your average person traveling might do 20 miles a day depending, are you on a mule? Wealthier people are going to be on horseback. Augustine usually eschews being on a horseback. He feels that it's too wealthy, what's the word, for him. So he'll usually be on a mule. But sometimes, when Augustine is on official business for the church, sometimes he'll be in a horse-drawn wagon, and that's more comfortable. It's more like our covered wagons from the Wild West. But usually he's on a mule with his friend. Just to finish up about Severus, Bishop of Milevis. Severus, we will see, is a very gentle, quiet friend of Augustine. As I said, they know one another from boyhood at Tagaste. They're in the monastery together for a while. Severus will be Bishop of Milevis just over 30 years. He is dear to Augustine. Another comrade whom we'll spotlight very briefly is Posidius. His name, I'm sure, is familiar to many of you because he was the first person to write a biography of Augustine. He wrote the biography about 7 years after Augustine's death. We scholars are indebted to Posidius for details about the Bishop of Hippo's life that would otherwise have remained unknown. A few years younger than Augustine, Posidius figured as one of the earliest recruits at the monastery at Hippo. So Posidius probably arrived at the monastery around 391, 392. Unlike the others from Tagaste, however, Posidius had not been fortunate to receive a good education in the liberal arts. So he had not been trained in grammar, logic, rhetoric, and the rest. However, in the monastery, he and others were tutored in scripture and theology by Augustine himself, so not a bad education. As Augustine observes in Letter 101, in such ways, Posidius fed on the good bread of the Lord, even though he didn't have the liberal arts training. 2 or 3 years after Augustine himself became Bishop of Hippo, Posidius himself will become Bishop of Kalama. You can see from the map, Kalama is close, and it's a gentle rise there, so it's not hard to go from Hippo to Kalama. So we really see Posidius and Augustine often together. They can join forces together, attend a conference together, or Posidius can get down to Hippo, or vice versa. It's Posidius who's left us that lovely vignette of when they would all join together at table in the monastery. Augustine had inscribed on the dining table, basically, no gossiping here. And it's Posidius who leaves us with that vignette. There are several others whom Posidius mentions in his biography of Augustine who were at the monastery. These men also go out and become bishops. So it's a real seminary of sorts that Augustine has started here. I can't go into detail about these others, but the book that I'm currently writing, Augustine and the Reformation of 393 AD, the Catholic Church is really starting to reform itself, starting in 393 with that Council of Hippo. So these other friends, I promise you, will appear in my forthcoming book. But I have to move on today. Now, sorry that I have to use eye drops. I need a quick eye drop break. Okay, so now we're going to be on the road with Augustine. As his reputation grew, Augustine could scarcely go anywhere without being invited to preach. For most of his career, he visited Carthage almost every summer, usually to attend the General Council. During the weeks that he spent in the capital city, he preached on numerous occasions in churches throughout the metropolis. As he traveled to and from Carthage, he often paused along the way to preach, at the invitation of local bishops. Bulla Regia is a case in point. So it's in the Magerta River Valley. Bulla Regia, it's a town, actually big city in Augustine's day. Returning from Carthage in early August, 399 AD, Augustine and his companions rode along the Magerta River Valley, stopping at the city of Bulla Regia at the insistence of its bishop. No doubt the heat was intense that day. The Magerta Valley is known for its withering temperatures in the summertime. When I visited North Africa, it was March, and believe me, it got hot in the afternoon in March. So you can imagine what it's like in August. So no doubt the heat was intense that day that Augustine and his companions stopped. There are archaeologists have dug at Bulla Regia, and they have found something that they have found nowhere else in North Africa, and that is in some of these beautiful homes, beautiful villas in Bulla. Archaeologists have found subterranean rooms, subterranean living rooms and dining rooms, because of the heat. The heat became so intense there that people actually dug a lair down if they had the wealth and would get away from the heat of the day in these subterranean rooms. So, Augustine, there he is, early August, preaching on the Feast of the Maccabees in Bulla Regia, and he gently chides his host for insisting that Augustine address the congregation. And I'll quote Augustine, "My brother has detained me, commanded me, beseeched me, forced me to speak to you." End of quote. All that Augustine wants to do is get back home to Hippo. He's been in Carthage for a while. He's been very busy there on church business and at a council. He needs to get back home to Hippo because his congregation really misses him, and they can kind of fall off track when he's away. So all he wants to do is go home. He really doesn't want to stop at every other town preaching, but this is his life. At the end of his life, in his Retractationes, Augustine recalls how often the burden of preaching was thrust upon him. I quote him again. "In early manhood, I had begun to write or to speak to the people, and so much authority was attributed to me that whenever it was necessary for someone to speak to the people and I was present, I was seldom allowed to be silent and to listen to others." End of quote. Augustine was keenly aware that most of the people at that time could not read. He says this in the Retractationes. To reach them, to change their hearts with God's grace, he recognized that preaching was one of the few effective ways to do so. And as we all know, Augustine excelled at preaching. His congregation would clap and shout when he dazzled them with his verbal pyrotechnics. And he was good at this. So he accepted preaching as part of the burden of being a bishop, and he tries not to complain about it, but he is always busy. He's always receiving invitations. He's always traveling to preach. All right, let's go on to a minor but jarring incident in 396 or 397 that illustrates the indignities that Augustine occasionally suffered from sectarian animosity while he was traveling. Augustine recounts this matter in letter 35, which he writes to Eusebius, a prominent municipal official at Hippo. Eusebius was a pagan and probably the procurator there. All right, here are the details. A Catholic subdeacon named Primus, whose church is at Spanianum, an estate near Hippo, has been defrocked. So a Catholic subdeacon, Primus, has been defrocked because of unseemly conduct towards several nuns. In a fit of fury, Primus becomes a Donatist along with two of the nuns. Here we go. To add insult to injury, the motley trio has joined a drunken and disorderly circumcellion crew that is roving around the countryside. The Circumcellions were the radical wing of the Donatists. So the Circumcellions, can cut your throat and kill you and that type of thing. if you're a Catholic. You do not want to fall into the hands of this Elliot. Dismayed at all these tactics, Augustine implores Eusebius, the official, to discuss these matters with the Donatus Bishop of Hippo, since the latter, the Donatus Bishop, is refusing to communicate with Augustine himself. Augustine strongly believes that Primus, the subdeacon's conduct, warrants dismissal from the Donatus clergy as well. He's already been defrocked by the Catholics. Augustine thinks he should be defrocked by the Donatus as well. But that's not the whole story in letter 35. The daughter of a tenant farmer at Spanianum has also embraced Donatism. Not only has she submitted to rebaptism, she has become a Donatus nun. Her enraged father, and he's a Catholic catechumen, is threatening to beat his daughter back to her senses. At this juncture, enter Augustine. He is crossing through Spanianum with a few companions and has attracted a crowd of local country folk whose humdrum day has suddenly waxed exciting with the arrival of Bishop Augustine. Has Augustine come to gather further evidence about the subdeacon Primus or to dispense advice to the daughter who's threatened with fisticuffs by the father? The narrative does not make his purpose clear, but what happened next is arresting. And I quote Augustine now. When we were passing through Spanianum, a priest of Proculeanus, the Donatus Bishop of Hippo, the Donatus Bishop, so a priest, a Donatus priest, standing in the midst of the estate, owned by a Catholic and praiseworthy woman, shouted out after us with a most impudent cry that we were traditores and persecutors. So this guy is standing there in the middle of this Catholic woman's estate, and he's shouting at Bishop Augustine and his entourage. This guy even hurled this abuse at the Catholic woman in the midst of whose estate he was standing. When I heard these shouts, and this is Augustine, when I heard these shouts, I not only held myself back from a fight, but I also quieted the crowd that was traveling with me, unquote. Augustine then admits that attempting to converse with such a dyed-in-the-wool schismatic usually is fruitless. I don't know about you, but it jars my sensibilities imagining Augustine so angry that he has to make a great effort not to punch somebody. His visceral reaction takes us aback. Nor do we normally envisage him physically restraining others from brawling. We are accustomed to picturing the Bishop of Hippo calmly dictating treatises at night to his secretaries, or animatedly preaching in his basilica, but not acting like a policeman. Nonetheless, with his honor and the lady's honor besmirched, the high-spirited crowd would have started a fight and only desisted thanks to Augustine's quick intervention. So, at the close of letter 35, Augustine begs the city official, Eusebius, to bring this incident to the attention of the Donatus Bishop of Hippo. And Augustine tersely advises, let him restrain the insanity of his clerics. You can see Augustine, you know, he's trying to be diplomatic, but he's also getting frustrated at the antics of the Donatists. We do not know how Eusebius responded to Augustine's plea, but we certainly can imagine the mood of the bishop's party as it finished traversing the estate at Spanianum that day. Perhaps Augustine and his companions were grim, knowing how deep-seated Donatus animosity towards Catholics could be. Let's see. Is it possible to detect quieter moments in Augustine's life as he attempts to upbuild the church? Yes, I think we can find some instances where this holds true. One occasion early in Augustine's episcopate is worth considering here, and this is from letter 44. Around 395, when he's traveling up to Curta, Augustine, Alypius, and several companions made a detour through the city of Tubursicu Numidarum. I didn't put it up on the map, but it's around there. So they're making a detour. They had heard encouraging reports about the Donatist bishop at Tibursacou, and he invited them, he invited Augustine and his party, together with a burgeoning number of onlookers, into his home for a friendly exchange. So during the early years, during Augustine's early episcopate, Augustine was eager to talk with Donatist leaders, to meet with them, to discuss with them, or to debate with them, in the hopes of persuading them to come into the Catholic fold. But before discussion could even commence at the Donatist bishop's home there, Augustine could tell that the throng was barely interested in matters theological. And I quote Augustine from letter 44, "There were very few in that whole crowd who desired that the issue be treated in a useful and salutary manner. The rest had assembled for the spectacle of our quarrel, almost in the manner of the theater," end of quote. Eventually, debate did get underway, but continual disruptions from the bystanders made progress slow. After a while, even the stenographers gave up trying to record the proceedings because of the crowd's unruliness. Even so, discussion lasted several hours. I won't go into all the details, just to say, the Donatist bishop was very cordial. Augustine and his companions would like to meet with him again. Augustine says so in letter 44. However, we never hear of this again. We don't know whether the Donatist bishop died. But the one thing Augustine says in this letter is, in the future, if he can meet with this bishop, could we avoid the disturbing crowds that are a hindrance rather than a help? We ought to meet in a village where neither one of us has a church, where there's no Donatist church, no Catholic church. Let's meet in a neutral place. I suppose where there are a lot of pagans, which there were many of still in North Africa. Augustine made visits throughout his diocese not only to upbuild the clergy, but he knew that he himself profited spiritually from these excursions. An enchanting vignette in Posidius' biography of Augustine reveals how deeply moved Augustine was by his visits to an older fellow bishop whose see lay not far away from Hippo. The two were dear friends. When the elderly bishop drew near to death, Augustine visited him frequently, praying that his friend would not pass away just yet, insisting that the church needed him still. Wisely, the friend replied that he could still be of service if he were never to die, but if he had to pass away someday, why not now? Because he's old, he's frail, he's dying. Si aliquando, quare non modo. Posidius tells us that when Augustine himself grew old, he often repeated those words. And here are Posidius' words. "Augustine marveled at that saying and used to praise the man who uttered it, a God-fearing man, certainly, but brought up on a country estate without much education or reading." Posidius never discloses the identity to us of this elderly bishop. Nevertheless, he created here a memorable portrait in miniature of two friends bound by common affection and, I think, uncommon faith. So here we have a perfect example of quiet moments that Augustine sought to upbuild the church and its servants. Despite his massive erudition and busy schedule, clearly Augustine cherished visiting with this simple country bishop. The two men probably never disputed the finer points of Trinitarian theology, but we can well imagine them discussing pastoral concerns and acknowledging God's grace in their lives as they shared a simple meal. Who was this aged friend? No one has definitively identified him, but I suspect that he was Sampsuchius, written the name on the board. I think he's Sampsuchius, a colleague whose name appears just a handful of times in Augustine's correspondence and in one canon. Sampsuchius was bishop of Tauris, a village whose location remains unknown to us, but must not have been very far from Hippo. Letter 34, which Augustine wrote around 396-397 to a Roman official at Hippo, is the first document to mention Sampsuchius, and then letters 33 and 35 offer supporting details. Newly installed as Catholic Bishop of Hippo, Augustine is eager to meet with his Donatist counterpart there, Bishop Proculianus. So Proculianus is the Donatist Bishop of Hippo. He's hoping to have a discussion about the differences between the two faiths. Much of what I have said earlier in this paper applies here as well. Augustine is happy to meet quietly with the Donatist Bishop of Hippo, Proculianus, without any intermediary, or simply exchange letters in order to avoid a disruptive scene with onlookers. But other problems crop up before the two bishops can engage in dialogue. Here we go again. A young Catholic layman nearly beats his mother to death and then becomes a Donatist. He submits to rebaptism at the hands of one of Proculianus' priests. The young convert continues to clamor for his mother's blood while still dressed in his baptismal robes at the door of the Donatist church. Augustine is shocked at these outrages. The church should protect widows, he insists. Moreover, rebaptism was now officially a crime, and Augustine demands that Proculianus report his priest's actions to the city officials for inclusion in the municipal records. In the midst of all this, more than ever, Augustine wants to meet with the Donatist Bishop of Hippo to discuss all this. However, that leader is balking, despite having been a bishop many years, and Augustine is just a new bishop. So what's going on? Augustine's formidable reputation in rhetoric has Proculianus worried. And so Augustine makes a modest proposal. He suggests that Proculianus meet not with him, but with Sansuccius, bishop of the Church of Tours, who has acquired no literary learning of the sort that Proculianus fears. I shall ask Sansuccius, and he will, I trust, readily grant me my request to take my place in this matter, and the Lord will, we trust, help him as he fights for the truth, a man, though not refined in speech, but is learned in the true faith. So Augustine is confident in Sansuccius's abilities to defend the faith, even though Sansuccius is a very simple country bishop. So just a few more sources. We'll look briefly at a few other sources where Sansuccius is mentioned. In letter 62, which Augustine writes in 402 AD to his good friend Severus of Milevis, Sansuccius appears in company with Augustine and Alypius. The three bishops have written, to Subsana. I know there are a lot of little villages and little towns in North Africa. The three bishops have written to Subsana, a village in Augustine's diocese, to resolve a problem involving Timothy, the lector there. Without Augustine's approval, and Augustine is the bishop, so his approval should have been sought, the priest of Subsana has elevated Timothy to the post of subdeacon. But this is only the tip of the iceberg. Augustine, Alypius, and Sansuccius discover, after much prodding, that Timothy has also served as a lector in three other neighboring churches. Plus, Timothy has also sworn an oath to Severus, far away in Milevis, that he'll be a lector there as well. So the whole thing is a mess. So from the tenor of letters 62 and 63, it's clear that Severus is not pleased by what's going on and that Augustine has been placed in a false position by Timothy. In short order, I can't go into the details, Augustine, Alypius, and Sansuccius resolve the problem. They interview Timothy. They find that Timothy is lying. And we see very shortly thereafter at the annual general council held not in Carthage this year, but in Milevis, under the watchful eye of Severus, we see what happened to this lector subdeacon is now being formed into a canon at the Council of 402. Canon 90 at the Council of 402 stipulates that if anyone has served as a lector, even only one time, he cannot transfer from that church to any other. So no more hopscotch. You've got to stay in the church where you started being a lector. So apparently the problem was so bad they had to make a canon about this. But my point in all of this is, once again, Augustine relies on Sansuccius to give a level-headed judgment when confronted with a pastoral dilemma. Alan, do I need to shorten this now? How much more time do I have?
Get your sense of the crowd is if you'd like some questions.
Okay, can I just, let me give my conclusion then. Let me give our final glimpse of Samsukius. We catch a final glimpse of Samsukius on a hot day in June 407 at the annual council in in Carthage. The Catholic bishop of Tubersicu Numidarum has fallen into trouble with some lay elders from a neighboring town. African canon law allows him to select seven colleagues to arbitrate his case back home in Tubersicu. He can select these seven colleagues, and then a few other bishops will be selected by the council. They'll arbitrate his case. So this bishop who's in trouble, for his seven bishops who are going to arbitrate, he chooses Augustine, Posidius, several other bishops, and Samsukius. Considering the large pool of Catholic bishops in North Africa, there are about 300 Catholic bishops in North Africa. It's telling that Samsukius is among the few whom Maurentius designates, whom he designates. So clearly, Samsukius had developed a reputation amongst his fellows for being fair-minded. We have no further records of Samsukius after that council. After 407, his name disappears from sight. So was Samsukius the aged friend in Posidius's poignant vignette, that elderly country bishop who's about to die and says, you know, why not now if it's going to happen? The few times that Serge Lancel mentions Samsukius in his excellent biography of Augustine, Lancel acknowledges a confraternal bond between Augustine and Samsukius, and Lancel says Samsukius was Augustine's usual consultant in the years 395 to 407 when he disappears from history. And Lancel also says Samsukius was Augustine's closest colleague, geographically speaking. But I honestly think, that this dying bishop probably was Samsukius, and we see how close Augustine was to him. My one paragraph conclusion now. In conclusion, there was much to keep Augustine on the road in his diocese of Numidia and elsewhere in North Africa. I've come to believe that his wide-ranging visits formed a crucial element in his overarching plan to revitalize the Catholic Church in Africa. His diocese was huge, and there was much to attend to. Augustine loved a crowd when its presence was appropriate, but he also craved quiet moments with just one or two colleagues. Those were grace-filled occasions. All of this will be in the book that I'm doing on Augustine and the Reformation of the Catholic Church. And it's the church needed to reform itself anyway, but what's goading it along is Donatism. And the Donatist clergy really did develop a reputation for holiness. And the Catholic clergy, as I said, they were in disarray. There were no seminaries. It's really Augustine starts the first monastery in North Africa. That'll be the seedbed for clergy. Questions?
Mm-hmm. Any questions?
This was just to get you out on the road with him. You know, Alan and I are always, you know, we're always at the Patricids Conference in Chicago every spring, and we're starting to hear papers from younger scholars who don't see Augustine as a human being. He's just this, I don't know what he is, some icon who's just sitting there in his study. Oh, I guess I'll write about grace. Well, yeah, I mean, it's not that bad, but we conversed in Chicago this past time saying, did you go to that paper? So we're just trying to human, he's a human being. He's a bishop for 40 years. Augustine is priest and bishop. He has a seat at the human carnival, ringside seat, for almost 40 years. I mean, you can see it from these shenanigans in this paper here. There's so much he has to deal with. And yes, in the evenings, after dinner, yes, then he can shut himself up in his study. Even then, he's not alone. He's got an amanuensis or two, you know, a stenographer who's taking down what he writes. These are lay people, actually, who get paid and stay up late with Bishop Augustine. And that's when he's forming his ideas. But you can say this too, and I heard this the other day at Mass at the parish chapel. You were like Augustine saying, help me with this problem. I mean, Augustine draws in his congregation, yeah, help me with this knotty problem. We've just read from the scriptures. Can we quite understand what's going on in this scriptural passage? And he's drawing everybody in. You really can't go to sleep when Bishop Augustine is preaching. So we're just, Alan and I are trying to show he's a human being, you know, he's brilliant. And a lot of these problems that he encounters in Hippo and on the road and against the Donatists and against the Palladians and against the Manichees, yes, these will go in. He'll figure these out in great treatises. But he's a human as well. No questions?
Something I was thinking about at the beginning, you had said that, I forget which person it was, like he was also into law.
Yeah.
Did they ever practice other things, I mean, or continue with their education in the field of
Augustine and his friends, or what? What do you mean?
Yeah, his friends, because you said they were educated in other areas.
Right. What they do, Augustine himself, you know, he's a boy in Tagaste, and then there's a town only about 20 miles away called Madauras. And basically it had good, well, we'd almost call them prep schools nowadays. There were good teachers in Madauras. Madauras was a very pagan town, in fact. Augustine's parents were ambitious for him. Monica and Patrick, Augustine's dad, they were ambitious for their son. They could see he was brilliant. Augustine had siblings, but the parents really bet their dollar, so to speak, on Augustine. So he set off to prep school, so to speak, at Madauras. Then when he's about 17, he'll go down to Carthage. It's not really college in those days. I mean, it's not a formal institution the way Villanova University is, but there were teachers of rhetoric, teachers of law, medicine. So Augustine will study rhetoric down there for a couple of years. He'll go to church in Carthage to find a girlfriend. There were new sermons of Augustine discovered in 1990. So we knew some of this stuff, but details have been fleshed out by the new sermons found in 1990 by François Dolbeau. So in the Dolbeau sermons, Augustine admits he's 17 years old and the cute girls are at church. However, the women are on one side, the men are on the other, but still you could look over at the other side and see all the women. We're not quite sure where he ends up meeting his common law wife. I mean, perhaps he met her at church. He'll live with her for 13, 14 years. They'll have a child. He will become, well, he'll teach rhetoric here. What is it? He comes back to Tagaste for a year. And then Alypius, his friend who's a little bit younger, and Alypius also is from Tagaste. Alypius will be down in Carthage. Alypius will have some of his schooling in rhetoric from Augustine. Then Alypius goes off to Rome. Augustine will follow. Augustine's very ambitious. He's brilliant. And when you are a rhetorician, you can make a fine career for yourself in the Roman Empire. Some of your governors of your provinces are rhetoricians. So Augustine would like that. He would like to end up as the governor of a province. So now, mind you, he's seeking and seeking. You know, Monica has brought him to church as a youngster, but then Catholicism just doesn't do it for Augustine. The Bible is off-putting. all those patriarchs in the Old Testament kicking up their heels. You know, this is not for Augustine. He joins the Manichaeans. They are a heretical group, but they're a very cohesive group. They've got their own scriptures. I can't go into Manichaeism today, but it's a dualist religion. God of good, God of evil. So yeah, Augustine is a Manichaean for 9 years. He goes off to Rome, gets a very good job there. And from Rome, he becomes the speechwriter, the rhetorician for the emperor. And the emperor, by this time, is not in Rome. The emperor is up in Milan, because you've got barbarian tribes north of Milan. So the emperor's got to be up there in northern Italy. So it's a very important post that Augustine has.
Just one comment. It seems to me that we spend a lot of time talking about Augustine and friendship and his ideas about friendship. And all of our examples are from the Confessions. And what you've done is talked about friendship being needed
among his
fellow bishops. And
if I have more time, and in my book, this will go into book, and there'll be more.
Right.
There'll be more. He's always relying on friends. Just the other day when I was polishing this paper, polishing is hardly the word for all of this, but I don't know where it is right now, but I wrote it down. It's back in my office. He's saying to somebody or other, you know, I'm sending you these chapters. I think it's of the City of God. You know this. And what are your comments? Send your comments back to me about what I've written thus far. And De Civitate Dei, in the City of God. So he's not alone on a mountaintop. He's constantly soliciting advice, comments. I didn't have time for it, but in one of these expeditions, Alypius leans over Augustine's shoulder. Alypius trained in law, and Alypius is whispering about a council that took place in the eastern part of the Roman Empire. And Augustine needed that information to say it to the Donatus bishop that he's chatting with. So Alypius is really Augustine's right-hand man, feeding him information. Actually, the information is not quite accurate, but but that's another story.
Any further questions? Well, thank you, Jim.
Okay,
I think somebody has to talk about the food.
There's food.
So,
okay.
Thank you, Jim.